Production underwriting for Ruckus has been made possible in part by the generous contributions from Fred and Lou Hartwig and from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to Ruckus, our weekly food for thought fight over the news of the day and the trends of the times. Attorney Steve Merakian joins the panel tonight. Steve is with the law firm of Warsh, Hobbs & Merakian. Always fun to have Steve on the program. Apparently, the congressman from Kansas City is not cleaning up in the car wash business. Bank of America is demanding payment from Congressman and former Mayor Emanuel Cleaver and his wife, Diane, of more than $1.5 million. The Cleavers own but don't operate a car wash in Grandview. Mr. Cleaver has declined comment except to say this is a legal matter and therefore he won't be discussing it publicly. Because part of the original loan is guaranteed through a Small Business Administration program, it's conceivable that if the Cleavers don't resolve this, taxpayers may end up footing some of the bill. In the past, Cleaver has seemed invincible in his political career, but could this issue be his last hurrah, Gwen?
No. No, I think that the electorate will evaluate the congressman based on his 20-plus years of stellar public service as mayor of Kansas City and the leadership that he has provided on Capitol Hill. Certainly, when the loan was taken out, he was an average citizen. He was not mayor, nor was he elected to Congress. His family pursuing a small business deal, which apparently has gone awry, as is the case for many small businesses in this economy. And so when you look at the situation, you do have to balance it with the economic situation. The car wash is still open and trying to make it, and many small business owners can, I'm sure, identify with Congressman and Mrs. Cleaver at this time. The other thing is, while, you know, and I certainly do believe that the congressman will do everything he can not to have this become a burden on the public to take care of his debt, but I think that one that we all have to recognize the terrible economic climate in which small businesses are trying to operate today and the difficulty in addressing these matters. So
I don't think the Kansas City Star editorial page is quite as sanguine about this as you are, Gwen.
Well, let's put it this way. Cleaver, at the very least, is guilty of being a bad businessman. And I mean, I understand the economy has part of it, but he's also had time along here to pay his tax bills, which he did a couple times, to work out, you know, some loan modifications with the bank, which, at least according to the lawsuit, he didn't do. Now, Gwen's right. That doesn't mean he's a bad congressman. No. But what it does indicate is that he cannot be immune to criticism and say, well, you know, we'll work at all that. It's just a personal matter. It's a business matter. No, you've got a matter that involves hundreds of thousands of dollars of public money. And at some point, some or a lot of that money is going to have to be paid by the public, which, you know, is not good. And I understand he wasn't a congressman at the time.
But whether he was a congressman then or not, he is a congressman now. And, Steve, congressmen are judged by different standards, are they not?
Well, yes, and that's why I understand what Gwen is saying, and I think the congressman, to all I know, has been a man of honor and has been an honorable person. But I also very much agree with what Yale is saying in the sense that congresspeople should be and are, in fact, held to a higher standard. There's a certain degree of trust that he holds for all of us. And when you mismanage a loan, which can happen to any of us in business, that's fine. But I believe that he owes it to the public to make a public statement, to talk about this, and to tell us how he's going to make sure that taxpayer dollars are not used to essentially bail out this.
Well, and Mary, you advise political figures, elected officials. What might you tell the former mayor, the current congressman, if he were to say, Mary, how should I be handling this? You know, it seemed to me if he had said what Gwen said, that would be better than saying nothing.
Well, I'd first tell him to call Gwen. That would be the first thing.
You'd turn down the business?
Exactly, I would. Well, Reverend Cleaver is just quite such a wonderful person, and God knows everybody can have problems in their business. However, it's not entirely accurate to suggest, Yale, that all of this loan is going to be paid back by the taxpayers.
Right. I did not say
First
that.
Of all, if it's sold, if they decide to sell it, for example, the property is quite expensive. The car wash is still functioning. No doubt it would bring in a good deal of money, depending on the economy. This is actually a private matter, Mike. This is.
No. Let's not go there.
Mary. Let me finish.
It is not a private matter.
This does have to do with his business.
Well, but the other.
And should he pay back his? Of course he should.
He should.
But he has a right to contest what the Bank of America is charging here. And good for him. Get a good lawyer.
There's another piece. I mean, when his lawyers have advised him not to make any comments because they are, you know, when you're trying to negotiate in these matters, you don't want to be making public statements.
Right.
So he's been advised. So,
honestly, Steve, and you would know better than I, would a lawyer say you can't say, you know, the economy's been bad, I've been trying my best, and I'm going to try to resolve this as quickly and as easily as possible?
This is where I disagree with Gwen. And we in our law practice, have represented public figures. And there's a difference between a public figure and a non-public figure in terms of the way it's dealt with the press. I don't know his lawyers, and so I don't know the advice they've given. But clearly, there are things that, as a congressman, he can and should be saying which do not impact the legal situation, but which do assuage the concern the public has about a person who is elected, who is handling public dollars, and where public dollars are at risk. And I believe he should be making some public statements to take responsibility for the things that he's going to control.
And one other thing is, we haven't really mentioned, but you know, he's earning $175,000 a year from the public. His wife has a job too. I mean, combined, who knows? I mean, they're in a couple hundred, $200,000, $300,000. There are a lot of Kansas Cityans who are current in the debts who make a lot less money than that. Now, they don't have $1 million loan. I understand it. But if they look at it and say, hey, we can keep our loans, why can't the congressperson?
And there are a lot of people who have mortgage issues with banks who have tried to make arrangements with banks to make payments that they could make, and the banks have rejected that and filed for foreclosure. So we don't know all of the facts. And he could have some of those concerns.
We have to move on. There could be a new reality show in the offing, Clergymen and the Courts. Congressman Cleaver, also a Methodist minister, is not the lone local clergyman in legal battles. The bishop of the Kansas City St. Joseph Diocese, Bishop Robert Finn, will stand trial in September. The bishop is charged with a misdemeanor linked to allegations of child abuse by a local priest. The prosecuting attorney claims Finn had a legal duty in his official role to report any allegation of child abuse. Finn's legal team says the bishop did not fit the legal definition of a designated reporter and is unfairly accused. This should be an interesting case to watch. What should we be watching for, Yale?
Well, the judge's rule that the trial should go on already said, at least in his opinion, yes, he does meet the provider description. That'll obviously be something at trial. I think this is the best thing possible for the bishop, because if it had been dropped, people have been going, yep, there it is, somebody, you know, trying to protect the Catholic Church once again. Once again, they skate off. I think, and as unpleasant it will be, as publicity and all that stuff, you have one of the highest, if not the highest ranking Catholic persons in the nation charged with some, you know, like sexual/abuse-related crime, go on trial, and if he's found not guilty, well, that's, you know, it clears him. It removes a little bit of the stain, certainly from the local diocese. If he's found guilty, of course, it's a major story and all that kind of stuff. But I think to have him, he'll have to put his viewpoints out there. It will also, I think, help clear up for probably the general public, what are some of these rules here? Because I think a lot of people are unclear on the provider thing. They're unclear about how the Catholic Church
apparently the
works
judge is not
too.
Unclear,
the
judging from what
the
you
judge
just
said. The judge said he meets it as far as I'm concerned, and that goes
the
on.
The judge is not unclear. Well, I agree with you. I think what we'll look for in the case is how well the prosecution, and I certainly commend our Jackson County Prosecutor Gene Peters Braker for bringing these charges, how well they are at proving what the bishop knew and when he knew it. And I think that's where it's going. And then how, why didn't he, once he knew that, make it public and file, you know, alert the authorities?
Well, the judge has been very clear in this case. He just simply said, I really like the way he writes, by the way, he said, this is not a complex case. It's actually a fairly simple case. And any jury should be able to look at the evidence in this case and determine whether or not the bishop should have reported to the police that what he saw in front of him, when he saw photos of little girls' bodies, pictures taken under their skirts, why did he not do what he was required to do under the law, which is to report that to authorities? Now, he said, apparently, now, if I have it correctly, through his very able and very expensive attorneys, that it wasn't his job, it was the vicar's, like saying it's the vice president. You know what the vicar said? The vicar said, oh, that's unbeknownst to me. I didn't know that I was supposed to do the reporting.
Much to my chagrin, one of those very expensive attorneys is sitting here, Mr. Merakian, and he's unable, constrained by certain legalities, not to comment on this case, even though your law firm is involved with it. Why can't you talk about it on the program?
Well, because the legal team, of which I am just tangentially a part, my partners J.R. Hobbs and Marilyn Keller and Jerry Handley are the ones handling this primarily, do not believe it's appropriate to make public comment during the middle of litigation. And so in respecting their views and Bishop Finn's views, and Bishop Finn feels the same way, that it's not appropriate for him to make public comments through his lawyers to try to influence anything. So we've decided that it's inappropriate to do that.
You think he'd like to guest on the program next week?
Was that? Yeah.
You think he'd like to guest next week?
But I will say this, and I won't comment about anything except to say, just for all those folks listening, how much it pains me not to be able to respond to what has been said by these three in terms of what's happening in this case.
There is a legal case about which you can comment, and it'll have to be brief, Steve.
Yes.
But the Trayvon Martin murder we want to talk about, or death, George Zimmerman has been charged with second-degree murder. Does that seem like the appropriate charge to you, Steve?
Well, I can't say whether it's the appropriate charge because obviously the special prosecutor has investigated this thing thoroughly and I haven't. I will say this. I've reviewed and researched the Florida law very carefully. And it strikes me that they are going to have an extremely heavy burden to make second-degree murder. Manslaughter would have been much more appropriate, and maybe they've overcharged in the hope that they'll get a plea to manslaughter. Yeah. But I'm telling you, there has been so much that has been misstated in the press with regard to this Florida law. And I'm telling you, the Florida law is not just a self-defense law. It provides immunity against arrest, much less prosecution. So the reason, there are lots of reasons what's going on here. If, in fact, the evidence is even remotely close to the idea that Trayvon, having been followed, then turned around and came back and threw the first punch, if that is the case, and I'm not saying it is, if that is the case, they will never make second-degree murder. They will probably not even get a conviction.
To introduce our next topic, a tune I used to play on rock and roll radio in 1971. It was a big hit from the five-man electrical band, and we dedicate it to the Kansas City, Missouri City Council. Kansas City, Missouri City Council, responding to East Side and South Side complaints, is attempting to toughen regulations on signs that pop up and stay around. One of the new provisions would be to fine first-time offenders $20 and repeat violators up to $1,000 per sign. Is this important legislation, Yale?
Yes, it is.
I've been writing about this for about 10 years, and just the illegal signs. And one of the things that has always been kind of bad about this is, you know, you can take down the signs, but you can't, you couldn't fine anybody for putting out there. Because companies did this. Companies do it all the time. Now, I understand a lot of them are the fly-by-night type corporations and, you know, yard sale or whatever. But they are ugly. They are a blighting influence in neighborhoods. Now, actually, in addition to the fine, I think the best thing the city has going for it is an education campaign. And I mean telling neighborhood groups, and this is actually part of the ordinance, telling neighborhood groups when a sign is illegally placed, in other words, it's on a public utility pole or it's in the easement between the sidewalk and the street, more people who know that on walks, on organized trips or whatever, yank the signs out, put them in the trash, recycle them, whatever you want to do. But I think actually having people be more aware of how you can be empowered, as I said in the editorial, to take the law into your own hands and, you know, rip these signs down, you can. There's one other aspect of this that people say, well, you know, you're hurting small business by doing this. This is how they advertise for these things. Well, that's bunkum, because there are plenty of ways to advertise these days, forgetting all even the real media of, you know, the social media and the Twitter and the Facebook and all that kind of stuff, the internet. There are a lot of ways to advertise. You don't have to blight neighborhoods anymore.
Yeah, well said. I think that the biggest impact may be on during political campaigns when mm-hmm. people are putting out their political signs and then they don't go back and get them. I think that's the part that's most irritating for me, is after the campaign's over, the election's over, then the signs are sitting there for weeks and months, the same signs. And I think that the community is now will be empowered to address it.
And take them out. Take it out. No, go ahead and rip them out.
An empowered community ripping down signs. That's
there you go, baby.
You have to have special training. You do have to have special training, do you not?
No, I checked on that. You don't have to have special training.
I mean, who among us has not hired somebody to mow the lawn that we didn't copy down the number in the car as we're driving by?
Yeah.
It happens. But yeah, good. Anything that makes the city more attractive. And right before all these people come for the All-Star game. Mm-hmm. You know, we want to look nice. So there you go.
Well, the thing about it is if it's okay to put this, if you do my lawn and I say you can put the sign in my yard, that's okay.
Oh, really?
I think
if you put it out
in the public thoroughfare, then that's different,
good.
I believe.
I never thought I would hear Yale in the same sentence espouse vigilantism and use the word bunkum.
Yeah.
And that's the most important part of this discussion.
He's in an upbeat mood because last week the Abohaka administration received another victory. First, it was a cut in the firefighters' budget. Uh-huh. And now the combining of the police department's health care insurance program with the city's.
Yeah. I mean, and I wrote a column this morning saying the victories aren't final yet because they're all little pieces that are still moving. But, I mean, the great thing is some of these fights take years. But they eventually need the right person or persons to push them along. City Manager Troy Schulte gets all kinds of credit for basically saying, I'm going to cut the fire department and I'm going to support this health care plan. Mm-hmm. And then you've got to give Mayor Sly James the ultimate credit of having the vote to say, no, I'm going to get the council to go along on the firefighter thing. Mm-hmm. The most amazing thing I've seen in 25 years of covering city government as far as the fire union goes. They got a big defeat there. Well, and on the health insurance, when he spoke out against it, Chief Forte, that was great.
The police employees are not happy with this move, are they, Mayor?
Some are not.
The police are not happy, and I think some of that may have to do with the fact that they're not accustomed to having a defeat, mm-hmm. at least as we, I don't see it as a defeat, I see it as an inevitable merging of the two. But, you know, I know, Yale, that you like to take great credit for all of this, but, you know, the mayor really is starting to look like the first year of Kate Barnes's of administration, where she did get a lot of changes made, and boy, he's making progress on his main issues. Good for him.
One of the key public political battles in Kansas is over making Medicaid private. Governor Brownback wants it done by the first of the year. Some legislators think that's unrealistic and are calling for at least a six-month delay until July of 2013. As we get started, a couple of basic questions. First, briefly stated, Mary, what is Medicaid?
Well, Medicaid is the federal, is a joint federal-state program that provides medical services and some long-term care services for pregnant women, children, elderly people, the developmentally disabled, as well as physically and intellectually disabled people, and lots of other people who are poor.
Yeah. And the program can vary from one state to the next state.
Well, it does, yes, but essentially the states run it. It was provided for in the Social Security Act, but the states run. This is essential services for poor people.
Okay, I said the key change, I guess, that Brownback is suggesting is privatizing Medicaid in Kansas by the first of the year. What will that mean, and what do you think about it?
It will mean just a giant change in the lives of 350,000 Kansans who are eligible for Medicaid. And some of these consequences could be extraordinarily dire, particularly for disabled people. You know, it's a very interesting thing. He's claiming that he didn't have to, and obviously is going to not go through the legislature to get this done. This is a third of the state's budget. He's going to simply hand over $2.9 billion, one-third of the state's budget, to private for-profit insurance companies. Where all of this was being done by not-for-profit and state agencies. And they will be able, he thinks, to cut millions of dollars, although he refuses to tell the public where the savings are coming from. Who's going to take the cuts? Is it elderly people? Is it developmentally disabled people? And finally, Mike, the counties are beginning to start to protest. The reason you haven't heard much about it, thanks to a couple editorials from the Star, is that legislators are so busy with all the other stuff they've got on their plates, and they've just washed their hands. He wants to wash the hands of the state government, of all of these people, and hand them over to United Healthcare, WellCare, and all the other for-profit agencies.
Might there be another point of view involved here, Steve?
Yes, there is.
What might it be?
I'm in favor of this because I think that the suggestion that I hear all the time and read in editorials and so forth is that why are we tinkering with programs that are working so well? Medicaid and Medicare are programs that are not working well. They are broke, and they are breaking the economies of virtually all of our states.
Is that the stated rationale of Brownback in Kansas and in other states to save money?
Amongst other rationale, part of the issue is that, like every state, Kansas is facing difficult fiscal times, and the idea of taking some of these programs, such as Medicaid, and putting them into the private economy, in my view, are good program, good ways to go, because the programs that we have right now are noble programs. We want to provide for people who can't provide for themselves, but we're not doing it in a wise way, and these systems like Medicare and Medicaid simply are going broke. They are already broke.
Well, that's
and
not
Steve,
true.
Yes, it is true. I was with you all the way up to a point where you said giving it to the private sector, Medicaid programs could make some sense, except the private sector said, we can't do it. We don't want it. I mean, Blue Cross Blue Shield, and they said we don't want it. That, to me, well, that was a big red flag.
That's now,
actually,
one organization.
That's,
what, not
that's the
all
biggest one. It's the biggest one.
Yeah. And,
but
now, not
I will
the only
say,
one.
I will say, in researching her editorials, Barb Shelley has not come down, and we have not come down totally on. Oh, well, you know, that's no. Don't tinker with it, don't do it. But it is. Wait a minute. There, you know, the rush to do it is right now what is bothering us, at least.
The timing
details are not worked out. There may be certainly some progress here as far as money goes, and actually providing the most important thing, better service to people. Yes, you may be able to do it, but let's get that worked out.
I think better services to people is also what's in question here. When you go to a one-stop style of service for medical treatment, especially for people who have been receiving medical care with their primary care physicians all this time, and now under this private system, who's going to be providing the care? What is the continuity of care for these people? And, you know, I just think it's a lot more.
We've got to go on. If this comes to fruition, three state agencies will be reorganized, and the governor says the state will save $853 million over 5 years, I believe.
Now we turn to roast and toast,
whether Ruckus pan or praise people at events and news. We start tonight with our guest panelist, Steve Merakian.
Well, I will tell you that my roast is, again, for the president. In promoting Obamacare, the president said, this law will not increase the deficit by one dime. And now the health care trustee has projected annual deficit increase of $470 billion. So the president was right. That's not one dime. That's 4.7 quadrillion dimes. But never fear, because under the president's plan to raise taxes on the evil millionaires, we'll get about $40 billion a year. That's enough to pay for 1 year's deficit in 100 years.
I'm toasting Florida State Attorney Angela Corey for announcing that, for filing charges against George Zimmerman, and for calling for the arrest, for his arrest on yesterday. And also saluting the Martin family for the gracious manner in which they have conducted themselves throughout this very, very emotional time as they mourn the loss of their son and galvanize this nation in support of a quest for justice.
Well, I'd like to toast Maury Thompson, who is the director of Johnson County Developmental Supports. And every single person in the state of Kansas who's finally stepping up and speaking out against Sam Brownback's attempt to hand over all of these Kansans and their health care to private for-profit insurance agency. The people in Johnson County have spoken out, Maury Thompson first among them, against the problems that are going to happen with developmentally disabled. Ed Eiler, Steve Rose, and everybody else leading the charge, good work.
Well, this is a toast to an Overland Park letter writer and the Kansas City Police Department. The letter writer this morning in the Star said she got a ticket for being a red light camera ticket for driving as part of a funeral procession. Said that wasn't right, said the Kansas City Police and Municipal Court should not be prosecuting her for that, and yet apparently they were. Just about an hour before coming to the show today, the Kansas City Police tweeted out, hey, yes, I'm on Twitter. They tweeted out that they're going to look into not prosecuting these kinds of things anymore, and that's a good thing.
And finally, I'm convinced that governments create acronyms before actually naming projects or programs, come up with cute initials first, then find the words. Here's the latest from DOT, Department of Transportation. The program where Kansas City is seeking streetcar funding is Transportation Investment Generating Economic Recovery, acronym TIGER. That is disgustingly, unseemly, moronically bad, acronym DUMB. And that's Ruckus for this week. Nick Haynes will host Kansas City Week in Review Friday evening at 7:30. Ruckus returns next Thursday. Now, on behalf of the Ruckettes and producer Sean Holmes, I'm Mike Shannon saying thanks for watching and good night.